decided to come and share with us this morning in our Ecumenical Prayer Breakfast. It has been a vision, a hope, and a dream of myself, and I will introduce Dr. Flippin shortly, and he will give you some background as to the steps that were ordered that allowed us to be here this morning. So we are delighted to have us here from all faiths, all religions, coming together on common ground, under a common roof, for a common purpose, to give thanks and blessings to all that we worship, who provides us with the insight, with the love, the caring, and determination to build this beloved community. I'm delighted that the living legend is with us this morning.
Amen. Amen.
The Honorable Andrew Young. When I introduce you, I'll tell the story that he's gonna tell on me before he tells it. So you can hear my version before he tells you his version, but every time in my career I've gotten in trouble or been in great need, I always call on Andrew Young, a man who marched across this nation at the right hand of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. that made it possible for the great-great-grandchildren of slaves and the great-great-grandchildren of slave owners to sit down this morning at the table of brotherhood. Is because of this man. And now I would like to ask Dr. Flippin, who will provide the sermon tomorrow. We will be visiting Greater Piney Grove, and we've invited all DeKalb County employees to share in a very special service of atonement, healing, and restoration tomorrow at the Grove. And Dr. Flippin will be delivering a sermon entitled A Leader's Resume. All right. Let's bring him to the podium, Dr. Flippin.
Good morning, good morning. How is everybody? All right. Oh my, when a Baptist preacher stands and sees all these people, I want to know where are the collection plates. We need to lift an offering this morning. It is a new day for DeKalb. Let's give God praise for that. A new day. And this past weekend has been wonderful. The inaugural sponsors reception was on Thursday. The honorary swearing in was on yesterday. And our ecumenical prayer breakfast is this morning. And then, my goodness, this evening, amen. Don't y'all stay too late because you got to come to church in the morning. When Miss Sasha the Diva gets through, you might need to serve communion tomorrow. The inaugural benefit gala for DeKalb DFCS foster children. Isn't that wonderful of our new CEO coming in and thinking about everybody? And tomorrow, the worship service, atonement, healing, and restoration. It was my wonderful joy to meet our CEO many years ago as I worked closely with his pastor and his home church in Athens, Georgia, Ebenezer Baptist Church West, Dr. Winfred Martin Hope, pastor. And of course, I knew Brother Mike just, you know, professionally. I knew his family in the church, and he might show up one night for revival. But I admired his work from a distance, and particularly being an African American elected many times to a statewide office, labor commissioner, and he did a mammoth job there. Did a great job there. What I like about our CEO, he has a similar upbringing as I did. His mother and father did not finish high school. They were sharecroppers, sold vegetables, did all they could to make ends meet for the children. But they insisted that all the children would get an education. And that was instilled in him and the children and they went on to get their education. It is ironic that as a boy, a young boy, he would hate going with his father selling vegetables in Athens. He was sort of embarrassed because his school friends saw him and he was out there peddling tomatoes, onions, bananas, whatever they were selling. But look how God moves in mysterious ways. It is that same route that his daddy took, that his first elected office was in that same district. I ain't preaching to tomorrow, but what a mighty God we serve. And there are people in here this morning. God, instead of you hating your upbringing and what's happened, use it. Use it. It was for your good, and it was for your making. And so when I was working with the Georgia Baptist Convention, I would hire persons to work for the Baptist Student Union in various colleges. And one applicant was Barbara Thurmond. She was in graduate school. I didn't know she was real broke. I did put together it was Mike's sister. I hired her. And since that time, he's been real nice to me. Came to the DeKalb County school system. Somebody ought to be hollering and shouting right there. Right. Teachers ought to be saying hallelujah. I mean, he came into that school district at a time that we needed leadership, honesty, some integrity, more integrity. The people who served did their best, but there were things that had just gotten out of hand. And he came in there, we prayed with him, and he did a magnanimous job with DeKalb County schools. Come on, give God praise for that. He did, yeah. And what I like about him, he does it with such ease, with such ease. So I did not know he was praying about his next move. He was ready to practice law again. And I don't know, maybe he came to church. I saw him and I said, Brother Mike, the Lord laid on my heart that DeKalb County needs you. Well, I've already worked for DeKalb. I said, no, the government. He said, you're the fourth person this week that said that. I said, well, out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, my word is established. You need to go think about it and pray about it. And the next time I saw him, after he convinced Zola, he had to go to Mama and ask. he came and he said, I'm running. And we've been behind him. We're excited that he was elected overwhelmingly. And we are excited about a new day for DeKalb. Yeah. It's going to be a new day. My wife and I moved here 40 years ago to go to Emory University. And we could have lived anywhere, but we chose DeKalb County because it had the best school system. It had the best neighborhoods. It had a good property value. I'm looking forward to go back to when DeKalb County was the number one county in the state of Georgia. It's going to happen. But it's going to take our prayers, and that's why we're here this morning. It's going to take our prayers. Amen. We are praying for the situation in Washington, D.C., aren't we?
Amen.
We prayed for Obama to get there, and we can pray for Trump to change. Amen. Come on, do you believe in your prayers? Amen. God can touch his heart. Once I had a meeting, and some people in the church had someone to come in and going to derail what we were trying to do. And the person that got up and was getting ready to speak for the opposition said, do you know what? I wish I had a church that had what y'all going on. If I was a member of this church, I'd go ahead and do what y'all doing. Boy, I said, look how God will twist their mind.
Yeah.
I got any preachers, witnesses in here?
Yeah.
And we'll help you out. So he has tried to include everybody in this room. There are clergy in this room. There are elected officials in this room, are concerned citizens in this room, are fraternities, sororities. He has included everybody as much as possible to be a part of this great day. Say amen.
Amen.
Amen. So we're going to ask if Dr. Joseph Williams is here. I haven't seen him. And so I will ask Reverend Kenneth Walker to come and do a welcome briefly. Everybody say briefly.
I will certainly be less brief than Dr. Flippin was.
I know you can say
we're Alpha brothers, so I can do that. When we look through biblical history, whenever God was about to do something great and grand, he would bring people from all corners of Israel to make it happen. Nehemiah did not rebuild the walls by himself. It was a team effort. And even as Nehemiah tried to rebuild those walls, he had the haters at the bottom of the wall. But Nehemiah said, as he looked down at his haters, I cannot come down because we were doing a great work. God has ordained and set aside a fellow Painite, a great man, Michael Thurmond, to be our new Nehemiah to rebuild the walls of DeKalb County. Not only will he rebuild those walls, but he will build bridges to the north side, the south side, the black side, the white side, the Republican side, the Democratic side, the free side, the tough side. He is going to bridge and bring us together. So today it is my honor to welcome you to an Ecumenical Prayer Breakfast where you will hear the plan how this man will help us to build new bridges in the 21st century. As I said to my congregation, because of what has happened in Washington, all of the action has to be at the local level. We changed presidents, but we did not change gods.
Amen. Okay, yes, sir. Yes, sir, that was good, wasn't it? And it was brief. Greetings, our friend Dr. Troy Bush. Invocation, Pastor Wanderlyn Stokes from the Deeper Life in Christ Church. And music selection, Nikki Foreman. Amen. If you would come in that order, and we'll get ready to eat. And Dr. Stokes, would you also bless the food? Thank you. All right, Dr. Bush? I saw you. I thought I saw you. All right, well, you've been greeted, haven't you?
Yeah.
Shake somebody's hand and say, you have been greeted. All right, Dr. Stokes. Dr. Stokes.
Good morning.
Good morning.
This is certainly a new day and a new hour for DeKalb County. And so, as a sign and a symbol of our unity, if you don't mind, if you would just touch the hands and hold the hands of the person that you're sitting beside so that we can unite together in prayer. Heads bowed. The Lord is our light and he is our salvation. So whom shall we fear? The Lord is the strength of our life. Of whom shall we be afraid? The Lord is our shepherd, and so we shall not want. God is our refuge. God is our strength. And he's also our very present help. Almighty God, we are gathered here today in this sacred hour of a prayer breakfast as a unified people who stand in spiritual solidarity to ask your blessings upon DeKalb County. We are pastors, clergy, we are religious leaders, political leaders, but most importantly, oh God, we are the community standing in need of your divine guidance and care. So we pray. We pray for our nation to promote liberty, freedom, justice, and peace for all. But we also pray for the people of this county, our children, our youth, our adults, our seniors, the sick, the homeless. We pray for economic, political, spiritual, psychological, environmental, and even the medical welfare of DeKalb County. We ask Almighty God that you would cover us, guide us and renew us in such a way that we become stronger and wealthier as a people and as a county. We thank you for our new leadership. We thank you for the shift that is taking place here in DeKalb County. We pray, oh God, that you will guide our new leader, that you will let the light of your divine wisdom direct his path. Let your light shine forth in all the proceedings, decisions, and laws that are framed for our rule and government. Yes. Let your light shine, O God, so that they seek to preserve peace and promote countywide happiness, prosperity, and success for all. We thank you, God, for all things. We thank you for our unity and our coming together. We ask that you would even bless the food that we're about to receive right now. God, let it be of wisdom and nourishment to our bodies. We thank you. There are so many that are in lack, but you have supplied for us. And we thank you. So we pray for those who are in need and those who are about to partake right now. Thank you, Lord, for all things. For we, the people, appeal to you, O God, for favor, blessings, and guidance of God in our county and upon our people and upon our new leadership. In your mighty name, amen and amen. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I am not Miss Nikki Thurmond. I'm not Miss Nikki Foreman. I'm Demetrius Mayette, so I'll be singing the first selection, and Miss Nikki will be here singing the second selection. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So can y'all just clap with me, just bear with me just for a minute, all right? All right. So since I am a good down-home Baptist, we just gonna sing a good down-home Baptist song this morning. Is that all right with y'all?
All right.
All right. How I got over, how I made it over. You know my soul looks back and wonder how I made it over. Well, how I got over, how I made it over. You know my soul looks back and wonder how I made it over. Well, soon as I see Jesus, the man that died for me, the man that hung and died, you know he hung on Calvary. I wanna thank him for how he brought me. I wanna thank him for how he taught me. I wanna thank my God that he kept me. I wanna thank him, he never left me. I'm gonna wear a diadem in the new Jerusalem land. I'm gonna walk the streets of Zion. I'm gonna tell how I made it over, how I got over, how I made it over. You know my soul looks back and wonder how I made it over. Come on, y'all sing with me this morning. Come on now. How I got over, how I made it over. You know my soul looks back and wonder how I made it over. Well, fix me, Jesus, fix me. Fix me if you please. Fix me while I'm standing here. Oh, you can fix me while I'm on my knees. How I got over, how I made it over. Well, you know my soul looks back and wonder how I made it over.
Yeah, man. Wonderful.
Let your church say amen.
Amen.
Let your church say amen again.
Amen.
Are we ready to have breakfast yet?
Yes, sir.
I don't think we're ready. Are we ready for breakfast?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'm going to give a little direction. First, we're going to have the dais here to go first, and we're going to ask someone to serve Ambassador Young. And following that, we have four serving lines, and we're going to start with the front center, please, and we're going to split the room in the middle. Those on my right go to my right, and those on my left will go to my left. And starting with this first center aisle here, you will go first, then this center aisle here, and work our way back, please. We'll let the head table go first, please. Follow them.
All right, how is everybody? How is everybody? Everybody had enough to eat? Okay, very good. Mm-hmm. Very good, very good. Well, you can... All right. And there are no more seats, but you're more than welcome to stay and stand and be blessed by what we're about to hear. The next person that will come with the brief change of the program is one that needs no introduction. Wonderful, wonderful friend and brother who has served this country, this world, and most recently as ambassador to the United States, United Nations. He is my frat brother. Amen. And so, because he has another appointment, as most of us do, we're going to ask if I think Virginia Reese, is it? She's going to sing. Introduce you, yes, sir. All right. Let's welcome our CEO.
Thank you.
Good morning. It is my honor and my privilege to introduce literally a living legend. And about 2 years ago, I was back in Athens, Dr. Flippin, and I was speaking with my brothers and sisters. And one of the things I shared with them was that one of the greatest honors that have been bestowed upon me is that this man named Andrew Young actually knew my name. Think about it.
Yeah.
A man who you knew only on the 6 o'clock news. A man who you saw at the March on Washington, in Mississippi, in the Delta, in Alabama,
right,
at the Edmund Pettus Bridge. A man who tragically stood on that hotel balcony in Memphis, Tennessee.
Yeah, right, sir.
A legend who actually knows my name. And he has come this morning as a personal favor. When the idea rose to try to bridge the gap, to cause the divide, the rich and the poor, the various faiths, there was only one man who could serve as a keynote for this address. His life has been a life of bringing people together, of overcoming barriers, of being courageous in the face of death, of never failing to speak truth to power, and never ever losing faith in God and the American dream.
Amen.
This man has come to DeKalb this morning to deliver this address. And I thank him, and I appreciate him, and I love him. And the next voice you hear after Miss Virginia Reese's song will be none other than the living saint, the living legend, a man who lived to see a dream transform the world. Andrew Jackson Young.
Georgia,
all right, yeah,
Georgia, Thank you. That was wonderful. I'm going to try to be brief and broad. I don't know how long ago it was, but I got a phone call. It was from a fellow by the name of Manuel Maloof.
Okay.
And he said, "Andy, we got a problem." I said, "What's that?" He said, "Gwinnett County has a moratorium on construction because they don't have enough sewage capacity." I said, "Why is that my problem?" He said, "Because you got some money to build a new sewage facility, but I hear you don't have enough." And he said, "I have some money to build a new wastewater treatment plant, but I don't have enough." He said, "You think you and I could get together? You got about 20 million, they tell me." He knew and I didn't know. Because he'd been around so long that my chief financial officer used to go by Manuel's almost every Friday to have a beer. And that's when everybody would get together. All of the news media, the bureaucrats, they'd all gather at Manuel's, and over a beer, they'd talk about everybody's business, usually in a good way. And he said, "Is that right?" I said, "If you say so." And he said, "Do you think we could get together He said, I got 20 million, you got 20 million, but Lillian doesn't have but 10 million. But with the 10 million, she could build a pipeline from DeKalb into, from Gwinnett into DeKalb, and we already are hooked up together between DeKalb and Fulton. And we can put together a wastewater treatment facility that will meet everybody's needs. I said, fine with me. He said, who do you have to ask? I said, I don't believe anybody. The way the water and sewer systems are set up, they run a little bit different. You know, they're independent corporations. I said, we can do it. He said, let me talk to Lillian and see if she wants to help. Over the phone, we put together a $50 million package, produced a project that met everybody's needs. And I don't think there was ever a vote. I don't think there was ever a criticism. And everybody's got wastewater. Everybody needs to flush a toilet. And that was that. I think that's the kind of relationship we need, where we are not in competition with each other, but we are in partnership. Now, Maynard Jackson did some things that I didn't understand, but he went around here building industrial parks, and I wondered why he was doing that. And part of it was because there were three guys who were friends of his, and one of them worked for what was then Solomon Brothers, Ernie Green, who had been one of the Little Rock Nine, I think was working for First Boston or somebody, and then there was another fellow by the name of Garland Wood, who were nice guys, who was with Goldman Sachs. Well, with three buddies of mine coming to me and coming to Maynard, saying, look, we have money to invest. And we're willing to risk it on the future of this region. So we built about 8 or 10 industrial parks. We put lights, we put streets, we put some water and sewage, and it was empty. And I didn't understand that while it was going on, but when they put me on the spot to be mayor, I said, what am I gonna do? And I remember there was a man from Japan who was on a plane sitting next to somebody I don't know, but he was crying because he'd been in Ohio for 6 months trying to locate a Suzuki factory to build motorcycles and golf courts. And there was so much red tape and so much bureaucracy in Ohio. He'd been there since January. He's going back to Japan in June, feeling like he's going to lose his job because there's no way he could get a plant open in the United States by October. And he sat next to a businessman from somewhere around here, and he said, call Andy Young. I think Maynard Jackson set up places where we could probably get you in business, you know, and 5 or 6 months. So when he called me, I said, come on in. He said, where? I said, just come on to City Hall. He said, what time is my appointment? I said, you don't need any. You got money, you got jobs.
Amen.
You are always welcome. And just tell people that whatever I'm doing, to stop doing it, because it ain't important as jobs and money. That's what this business is all about. lo and behold, he came in, and when I found out what he wanted to do, there was a place right out there on Bankhead that was exactly what he needed. And we got on the phone, and somebody took him somewhere that I didn't know. He came back and thanked me. He said, "You saved my job." And he got his plant open for about the middle of October. From June to October, he built a factory and opened the plant. And then something happened that made him mad. He called me. I gave him my phone number, so if anything went wrong, he didn't have to complain. Call me. And he called me, but 3 o'clock in the afternoon in Japan is 3 o'clock in the morning here. And so I get this call at 3 o'clock in the morning, and he said, "You all are just like the people in Ohio, only you all are smarter. They tried to shake me down before they got me set up. You wait till I get set up, and now you want to shake me down. Who do I have to pay off to get this plant open?" I said, wait a minute. "It's 3 o'clock in the morning. Give me a minute." And I said, "What is the matter?" He said, "Everything is in place, and they won't turn on the lights. Who do I pay to get the lights turned on?" I said, "You don't have to pay anybody to get city services in this city. And I guarantee you, if you give me a couple of hours, I will figure out how this is done." And so I called a fellow by the name of Norman Copeland, you all probably know. And I could wake Norman up in the middle of the night, and I said, "Norman, what's the matter? Why can't..." He said, "Remember when we were trying to open up the airport, and we couldn't turn the lights on at the airport, and Maynard Jackson got mad?" And I said, "Yeah, I remember that." He said, "The only problem was, we can't turn on any electricity unless we have an insurance policy. Give me an insurance policy." And lights go on. So I called him back by 5 o'clock in the morning. Got his phone number, his insurance number. The lights were on by 8 o'clock. Everything went well. Now what happened was, he went all over Japan talking about how they take care of business in Atlanta. And we now have over 650 companies from Japan scattered around this metropolitan area. Same sort of thing happened with Germany, only the Germans had big factories, big plants, and the German population is getting old, so they're not spending much money. And so we went to Germany and we said, "Look, if you're going to be in business in the 21st century, you got to be in the United States market. No other market in the world is growing. If you're going to be in the United States market, the best place to be is metropolitan Atlanta, because you can get to 80% of the market in 2 hours from our airport." And lo and behold, they understood that, and they started coming in here. Now, we hear about Porsche down there in Clayton County, and there was somebody I met here from Clayton County. And we hear about Mercedes moving into DeKalb County. And I'm not upset about that. My children got me straight on that. They said, I said, "Why is it you all don't shop at Lenox Square? Why don't you shop downtown? Why you go out to Cobb County or way out to DeKalb?" She said, "Daddy, nobody cares about city lines but y'all politicians."
Yeah, you're right.
We shop where we get the best bargains. And so you just as well get used to it. You can't change that. Well, when business comes anywhere within 100 miles of this metropolitan area, it serves us all. Very few of you here work just in DeKalb County. Nobody in Atlanta works just in Atlanta. I mean, we are unified. And we just as well quit dividing our mentality and work together. Now, you done picked a unifier. And he knows I'm gonna tell this, but he called me one day. He said, "Andy, I need you to go with me somewhere." I said, "Where?" He said, I'm almost there. Just come on down. I'll tell you when you get downstairs." So I came down to City Hall. I said, "Where are we going?" He said, it's right up here." So we drove in a back way into the state capitol that I didn't know, and we got out and we went through some strange passages that he knew that I didn't know anything about. And we go up an elevator, and we get in this hall. As we get off the elevator, everybody starts clapping. Hey, like they were waiting to see us. They were so glad to see us. It was like the party was just for us. And I looked around, I said, "Mike, where are we?" He said, "They're glad to have us, Andy." I said, "Yeah, but who is this?" He said, "I didn't want to tell you because I didn't want you to back out, but today is Confederate Memorial Day."
I would have gone,
but he didn't want to take the chance. But what they said was, "We are so glad that you came here, because everybody thinks because we celebrate the values of the Confederacy that we're celebrating and want slavery to come back. The Civil War was about more than slavery, and we want to preserve some things that our ancestors died for that did not have anything to do with slavery." And we were so welcomed. And they were so pleased that we had a good time. And we realized that we are all more Southern than we realize. Now, part of what happened in this last election, and I'm not going to be long, is that, what you saying thank you for? Long time ago?
I said thank you for talking about it. No, thank you for talking about it.
I thought he was thanking me for not being alone.
Thank you for talking about it.
But we were so anxious to celebrate the progress of this nation. And it is progress. It's progress when, well, I went to my first gay marriage about a month ago. And they were young ladies that my wife had taught in fifth grade. And they both had PhDs. One was a psychologist and one was a research scientist at CDC. And, you know, it was a good wedding. and they were very, very compatible. I mean, they were great partners. And it ain't none of my business whatever else goes on. But I had a very good time. But that was an adjustment for me. And there are a whole lot of people that wouldn't even go. They just, "It ain't my way. I ain't got nothing to do with that." But the Democratic Party celebrates the capacity to accept change. And nothing is happening new. All of this has been going on all the way back to the Bible. And if the preachers are getting uncomfortable, go back and check Jesus out in the 19th chapter of Matthew. And Jesus says, wait a minute, he's talking about marriage. And he says, now, this is going to be hard for you all to understand. He said, but some are born eunuchs. Others are made eunuchs by men. Still others choose to be eunuchs for the sake of the kingdom. Now, think on that, because only a few will understand. And that's true to this day. But we're working on that. And we're working on getting people out of jail for mass incarceration. We realize that we got more brain power wasted in jail that we need to be working. But we haven't figured out how to put everybody to work yet. And I'm going to give you an assignment, and that is go to your on-demand on your television set or something. Or go to somebody's house who has it. Took me a long time to get a television set, but I always knew somebody who had one where I could go see the football games or the fights, anything I want to see. So find on demand and find out what Diane Sawyer had on television last night about the rising income gap.
Right.
People who are taking 6 and 8 buses to work to make $8 an hour. Brilliant young men and women who are sacrificing and suffering and can't get by because it's $10 an hour. But then there was a hope. And the hope was in Aetna Insurance Company. And they said they suddenly realized when they understood how little their people were being paid, that it was in their interest to pay them more.
Yeah.
And they said, as they raised our salaries, they worked better.
Yeah.
He said, it didn't take anything away from our shareholders. It didn't take our profits down. It just meant that we were running a better and more efficient operation. And we all felt better working together when we narrowed the income gap between the rich and the poor. And that's what we have to do in this region. Unity doesn't just mean racial unity. It doesn't mean just religious unity. It means basically, according to what Martin Luther King had to say, we were fighting to redeem the soul of America from the triple evils of racism, war, and poverty. And poverty now, I saw some figures which I don't quite want to believe, but the average income of a white family of four in the metropolitan area is $86,000 a year. The average income of a black family of four in the metropolitan area is $18,000 a year. Now, that may be not quite accurate, because they do that by zip codes. And it might not be black and white, but they just the majority zip codes, and they pick the poorest zip codes and some of the richest zip codes. But what we know is that some poor white folks in those poor zip codes too. And there's some rich black folks in those rich black, those rich zip codes. And so while it's not as bad as people say it is, it's not nearly as good as it ought to be. And that is the challenge that we face in kind of keeping this metropolitan area going. But we're not going anywhere. I mentioned the German companies coming here, and they're not bringing a whole lot of Germans with them. The state is training people to work in these plants. And I never thought, I really felt guilty when we built the Olympic Village and we moved all those people out of Techwood down to Clayton County. Now, they had really nice houses down there. The houses were better than, but they were so far from the jobs. And it was kind of rough down there at first because they were new and they weren't welcome and there were some tensions. But then last month, the fastest growing county in the United States, I think, was Clayton County, Georgia. I mean, you need to clap for that. Now, part of the reason is Porsche moved in there. And Porsche moved in there, and pretty soon their suppliers are going to start coming in. And pretty soon, the southern end, and I mean, people got to go somewhere. They can't go any further north. They got to come over here, and they got to come south. And this area is just beginning to take off. And there just happened to be 2,500 German companies in the metropolitan area. Now that's the first time I went to see some of my banker friends, and I said, look, there's no money in Washington because I don't think that Ronald Reagan would give us any if he had any, but there is money, and we're gonna find the money and bring it in here. And he said, where are you gonna get the money? I said, from Germany, from Holland, from Japan, from anybody that's got money, we're gonna invite them to come here. And they started coming, and they liked it. 2,500 German companies? That's more, there are only 3,000 in the whole United States. 2,500 of them in metropolitan Atlanta. Wow. And they like it here. And they don't get involved in all of the pettiness. Now, I'm going to say this, but it ain't going to be anymore. This was a county. To have brilliant young men and women fighting over absolutely nothing, there's no other word for it. And I want you to go tell them that, because it's embarrassing, but it ain't gonna be that way no more. We are working together from here on in. What happened to us in November? And then I'm through. Donald Trump played on everybody's weaknesses. And he sort of ignored the strengths, because the truth of it is, most of the people that voted for him, black and white, are like the people that were on Diane Sawyer's show.
Yeah, that's right.
That they were working for $8 an hour, and we're talking about all the progress we're making, but they ain't making it. And they wanted a new way. Now, we worried about the immigrants, and we should, and we worried about everybody else, but we forgot working America. We forgot the mainstream, hard-working citizen that saves his money, takes care of his children, loves his wife, tries to make the family make sense, but they cannot make it in this day and age. And we, and I'm guilty of this, have been so busy celebrating the progress, like I just finished doing, that we forgot the least of these. Yeah. And I don't know what he's going to do for them, but in a democracy, it's a waste of time to get mad. Amen. Because we believe in democracy more than we believe in Democrat or Republican. The first time I came to Georgia, Maynard Jackson's grandfather said, now, we want you to go down to South Georgia and run a voter registration drive, but we want everybody to vote Republican. I said, but I'm a Democrat. He said, you were a Democrat when you were in school in Connecticut. But down here, we have to be Republican. And I said, why? He said, because if Stevenson is elected, Richard Russell nominates all the judges. If Eisenhower is elected, there were no white Republicans back then. We will nominate the judges. And I said, well, I guess, okay. I wasn't comfortable with it, but every judge that decided a civil rights case in our favor, this was 1956, between the Supreme Court decision and 2000, happened to be a Republican appointee. And Judge Frank Johnson, Judge Tuttle, Judge Minor Wisdom in New Orleans, Judge, the judge that saved us in St. Augustine. And I mean, it made sense. And so I think we have to say, and I'm saying this before I was a Republican or Democrat, I was an American. And before I was an American, I was born a Christian. And before I understood about Christianity, I knew I was a child of the Creator of heaven and earth. And that all men, women, and children are created in the image of the living God. And by whatever name we call him. And I did not learn about Jesus from my church. I learned about Jesus from Gandhi, who was a Hindu. Because he was putting what Jesus said into action. And so we have learned, when my daughter moved into a neighborhood in Atlanta, and I went to see the lady across the street, because this is my baby daughter, and I said, look, I want to give you my phone number. I don't want you spying on my daughter, but in case things are going wrong, I wish you'd give me a call. And she said, Mr. Mayor, you do not have to worry about this neighborhood. He said, this neighborhood is predominantly Muslim. And Muslim women do not work. They're in the neighborhood all day long taking their care of their children. Muslim men have made sure there is no crime. We haven't had a break-in in this neighborhood, you know, since they opened the mosque. And I think that that's what we have to understand and celebrate. Now, I see some good in the Trump administration. Because, see, we went to war in Vietnam because McNamara didn't know anything about the Vietnamese. We went to war in Iraq because Bush didn't understand the difference between Sunni, Shia, and Kurds. And if they had, they wouldn't have created that mess. You know, and Colin Powell said, if you break it, you own it. And almost so many places in the world where we have broken things up that were stable. I dealt with Gaddafi, and Mandela dealt with Gaddafi, and he was crazy. No doubt about it. But if you showed him respect and gave him an understanding of what you were trying to do. In fact, three or four presidents went to see him and said, look, we want your involvement in Africa, but we don't want you sending any more guns. We want you to help us with food. We want you to help us with education. We want you to help us with healthcare. And we need you, and infrastructure development. And he came along. I'm saying that the world can be run peacefully. And the reason I like the new Secretary of State, even though he's an oil man who has worked in Kazakhstan, in Angola, in Nigeria, in Papua New Guinea, in the North Sea. And he worked as an engineer on the rigs, and all of those rigs have more of the local people than they have engineers from America. And so he knows people from all over the world, and he's not likely to do something as stupid as some of the things we've done in the last couple of decades. And I don't know. He might get along with the Russians, but I hope we do. Anybody that's got more nuclear weapons than they know what to do with, you got to figure out how to get along with them. And Jimmy Carter got along with them, but before Jimmy Carter, Hubert Humphrey took Archer Daniels Midland and Occidental Oil to Russia, because if Russia had fallen apart back in the 60s, the world would have been going to hell in a handbasket. And so Armand Hammer helped the Russians to develop their oil rigs, and that supplied oil to Europe, and that's the reason our oil prices didn't go through the roof. Dwayne Andreas of Archer Daniels Midland gave a young Russian agriculture minister a copy of the biography of Franklin Roosevelt. And he said to him, Franklin Roosevelt had to reform capitalism to save it. Somebody's going to have to reform communism because it can't exist like it goes now. That young man happened to be Mikhail Gorbachev. And he did a lot to bring Russia around so that at least we know each other and we can disagree on anything we want to, but nobody's threatened to drop a bomb.
Yeah.
Nobody's threatened to fight. And so let's look at the positive. I'm old enough now to remember the Second World War. Some of y'all, all, a lot of y'all old enough, but you don't want to admit it. But I'll be 85 in March. And in the Second World War, how many of you remember the Andrews sisters? They had a song that everybody sang. You got to accentuate the positive. Eliminate the negative. Latch on to the affirmative and don't mess with Mr. In Between. To illustrate my last remark, Noah and the whale. Jonah and the whale, Noah and the ark. What did they do? Just when everything was looking dark, they had to accentuate the positive.
That's it.
Eliminate the negative, latch on to the affirmative, don't mess with Mr. In Between. So when I put all that I've said together, you know, I come back to an old song they used to sing down in Beechton in my first church in Georgia back in 1956. Old man used to get up and say, I got a feeling, he was just that flat, that if things gonna be all right, oh, I got a feeling, everything's gonna be all right. Don't you know I got a feeling, everything's gonna be all right. Be alright, be alright, be alright.
Oh, I love you, man.
And
the ambassador has to leave early to a, he has a board, he's on the board of trustees at Morehouse College. They're meeting this morning, so let's give him another round of applause.
Please, if you can stay, we're going to now go to prayer. If you might be seated, so we might move along. Amen. Prayer for the County of DeKalb, Dr. William Watley. St. Philip AME Church, prayer of wisdom, Dr. David Jones, Decatur First United Methodist Church, prayer of unity, Imam Abdullaha Jaber, prayer for peace, Bishop Kenneth W. Carter, CME Church, 6th District, and let them pray in this order. And if we could have soft music while they pray, we'd appreciate if they would come in this order.
Let us pray. O thou in whose presence our souls take delight, on whom in affliction we call our comfort by day, our song in the night, our hope, our salvation, our all.
Yeah.
We thank you for the freshness of this morning.
That's right.
Yes.
And for the newness
Yellow.
Of this administration.
Yeah.
We lift him before you, and we pray that when the celebration is over,
that's it.
He has to make the hard decisions
Lord,
of governance that may offend some of us and even the press, that you would give to him the courage to make those decisions
yeah.
that are in accordance with your will, trusting you to bring him through to victory.
That's it.
We pray that you would keep this county from graft, greed, scandal,
that's it.
And the kind of petty undercutting
Lord help.
That takes away from the quality and character of life for all of us.
Right, Reverend, right.
Now we commit this county, its leadership, and those of us who work, serve, and live here into your hands, and we pray for your continued presence and favor
yeah.
and a future that is truly new, because we will be known as the county that honors you. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ,
yeah.
who needs no election
no.
and no inauguration, but who reigns forever. It is in his name that we offer this prayer.
Yeah.
Amen.
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 Lyman Beecher was a theologian, a preacher, a social reformer in the years leading up to and during the Civil War. And on one occasion, Lyman Beecher walked into his pulpit. He asked the people in his congregation to bow, and he prayed this prayer. He said, O God, grant that we may not despise our rulers.
Uh-huh.
And grant, O Lord, that they may not act in such a way that we can't help it.
Yes, very good.
Now, to be a kind of leader that is admired and respected and not despised calls for character.
Uh-huh.
It calls for competence.
Yeah.
It calls for compassion.
Listen.
But it also calls for wisdom. And that's what I've been invited to pray for, and I invite you to join me. Living and loving God, you created all things in this universe. And you looked at it one day and said, that's good. And you worked more and you looked at it and you said, that's good. And you kept saying, that's good and that's good and that's good. But you never said, it's perfect. In your wisdom, you left creation incomplete so that you could invite us collectively and individually to join you as co-creators, as stewards of creation. Our history is that we do well and then we do poorly. We rise up and then we fall down. We choose wisely and sometimes we choose foolishly. Nevertheless, you have infused all of creation with a moral order that transcends our various religions.
Yeah.
And you have given us the mental, the spiritual, the emotional capacity to discern your will and choose to do it. Scripture reminds us of the prayer that our old people will see visions and our young people will dream dreams. hearts and our minds are very much on one who had a great dream for this country this weekend. Where there is no dream, where there is no vision, people perish. But where there is a dream, people flourish. People say it can be better tomorrow than it was today, and it can be better the day after tomorrow than that. So we pray for all of our leaders. Because you called us to pray for all of our leaders, we pray for Donald. We pray especially for Michael, who with all due respect has a good head start on the other I've just named in understanding what your vision is. But we pray that both of these and all other elected leaders will somehow rise to the occasion and meet the challenge, and we know that they will only do that through prayer, through worship, through walking closely with you, so that they can advance your wisdom. Finally, Lord, we remind ourselves that none of our leaders can do it alone. So use all of us and help all of us to use our common sense to seek common ground for the common good. We make this prayer in your holy name, and your people said, amen. Amen.
Everybody.
Good morning.
So I had written down a specific prayer to share with you, but after the respected, honorable Ambassador Andrew Young, I had to change that because he took care of most of it. But when I was 18, I traveled to South Africa, post-apartheid period, and when I got there, my teacher. He shared with me, he said, what is life about? And I had to think for a second, what is life about? And he said, well, let me tell you what's life about. He said, life is about memories. And it's the memories that you create through your actions and through your deeds. And this weekend, we're going to remember a man who created memories. And he said, there is no yardstick to measure how close and what's your proximity to God? There isn't. You can't take a measuring stick to measure how close you and I are to God. But he goes, there is one that the prophets of God and the men of God have left. And that is how well you strive to unite humanity, not divide.
Yes.
It's how well you strive and sacrifice to bring people together. And that's a memory that MLK left behind, uniting people. So in that, I've been asked to pray for unity. So I ask you, brothers and sisters, to bow your heads and join me in prayer. Dear God, we stand in front of you, remembering the words of the messenger of God, Muhammad, and Jesus, saying the best amongst you in the court of God and the best amongst you in the sight of God are the ones who are most beneficial to humanity. Right now, we are standing in a moment in history where there is division, but we ask you to bring our hearts together.
Please, Lord.
At this moment is full of promise, but it's also liability.
Lord, help.
This beautiful city, this promising state, this great country will either move forward toward unity and widely shared prosperity, or it'll move apart. And as we gather here today to plan for a better tomorrow, let us all keep in mind that we are going to create memories.
Right.
Memories that the generation, the millennial generation, will be affected by, and they will remember us through these memories.
Right.
So let us do our best preparation for tomorrow. As Malcolm X said, you only have today to prepare for tomorrow. The most loving and most beneficent, we thank you for all your favors and bounties. We thank you for our families and friends and colleagues. And we ask you to give us the ability to love those even who criticize us.
That's true.
We ask you to bless us with foresight and knowledge so that we may unite. We ask you to send the blessed rains of your mercy and love upon our frail hearts, our frail and weakened hearts that gives us life, a life full of love. We ask you to give us the ability to sue good and strive towards it, and to shun evil in every form that it comes in. For many today, we are surrounded by the rhetoric of division and hate and misunderstanding, that we have become victims and that we have become desensitized, and our hearts don't know how to cry anymore. Our eyes don't shed tears anymore. We beseech you to rectify our souls and our spirits, because it is Jesus who said, is not life more than just food, and is not the body more than just clothing? Give us the ability to love one another, and we admit to you that although we reside and live in the United States of America, division has entered our ranks. The most beneficent, keep us close to our heart, to your heart, that this one nation under your name with liberty, freedom, and justice for all. Thank you.
Amen. 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 Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Let us pray. Mother and Father God, we, your servants, have come at this appointed time in this appointed place to give your name all praise and glory. We come praying for peace, peace in this wonderful and divine county of DeKalb. We pray for peace that shooting and killing of our own children and humanity will cease. We pray for peace between law enforcement and community. We pray for peace for this great state of Georgia, that there will be peace in our schools and community. We pray for peace in these United States. For this upcoming week, there will be a transfer of power. We pray for a peaceful transition. And Lord, we pray for peace for this world, a world that is war-torn, a world that is filled with terrorism, attacks, and hacking. But Lord, we know that you're able to do all things. We pray for the young, and we pray for peace between the young and the old. We pray for peace between black, white, Latinos, and Asian, and all ethnicities. We pray for peace in our religion and religious world, between the Christians and Catholics and Muslim and all religious groups.
Peace.
We pray for peace.
Oh God, we need
between Republicans and Democrats. And we pray for peace now, Lord, for this your servant, Michael Thurmond. We pray that you would give our CEO your perfect peace. Peace in his home with his lovely wife, Zola. Peace upon the job with all of the employees that he will be overseeing. Peace in his community affiliations. Peace in his national and international ventures. Allow him to rest at night with all the weight that is upon his shoulders. Give him sweet peace to rest knowing that you are able to bring all things that are good to pass. These, Father, are the blessings we ask for you this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Wasn't that powerful? Oh my. Oh my. Please, if you would just stay with us just a little longer. I wanted to make sure we introduce the First Lady of DeKalb County, Mrs. Zola Thurmond. Would all the Reverend clergy please stand?
Thank you so much for being here. Our national elected officer, Representative Hank Johnson. I don't know if there's anybody else. State elected officials, please stand. Well, thank you, Gloria. DeKalb County appointed position, Chief Cedric Alexander is appointed. I saw him right here somewhere, right before me, all right? DeKalb County elected officials, will you please stand? Our sheriff, wonderful. DeKalb County Ministers Alliance, those that are here, those that are not a part of this group, Reverend Dowell is our president, you'll hear from him later. Please get connected. We want to help Brother Thurmond with prayer and ecumenicalism and make a difference. So please see him. And might I just take special privilege, the very fine brothers of DeKalb County, Nu Mu Lambda, what I'm a member, is here to support us. I want them to stand, and we thank you for being here. Ada Lambda is here. Would you please stand? Are there any other fraternities, sororities that are represented? Deltas, come on, stand. Whoever's here, we need everybody. Sigmas, AKAs. All of us have got to work together. Amen. Well, we want to, now, I'm going to follow our CEO's directions. Nikki is supposed to sing, but he says we need to be finished in 15 minutes. So now, do we want to go to the panel discussion now or sing?
Panel. Let's do a quick panel.
And then we'll sing, and then the rabbi will send us on our way, all right? So those that are at the head table, if you would not mind, unless you're on the panel, excusing yourself, and if Dr. Alexander, Dr. Ken Samuel, Reverend Stephen Dow, and there are some others that have been asked by the CEO, if you'd make your way to the front, I'd appreciate it so very, very, very much. All right. Please, if you can, stay.
Say a few words.
Say a few words.
Go right ahead.
You want me to?
No, that's two pastors.
Come on, Doc. Yes. All pastors, if you come quickly, please.
We just say a few words.
Thank you. Yes. All right. Let's welcome these wonderful persons to the podium. And why don't we start with Brother Cedric Alexander to set the tone of what we want to talk about. And then the ministers will come and have what we used to say in the Baptist church, scattering remarks.
Good morning.
Good morning.
This has been a wonderful event this morning, wouldn't you say?
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. Let me, before I say anything, it's always important for me as public safety director to always bring notice to the men and women who do such a tremendous job in keeping this county safe every day. All those that are members of public safety in DeKalb County Police, Fire, Emergency Management, please stand up so we can give them a great round of applause. One of the most important things that myself and the CEO have talked about in the last number of months, and particularly the last couple of weeks, has been the importance of public safety in this community. How paramount it is if we're going to grow and build this community is that we have to have good public safety. And to have good public safety, we also know in the 21st century, is that we have to have good community relationships.
Yes.
I can name to you hundreds of occasions over the last 4 years that I've been here. I've had an opportunity to work with these clergy that you see up here and across this room and tell you a number of tremendous stories that would just be so heartfelt. And I'm going to share one very quickly. If you remember several years ago, there was some bad guys who kicked in a back door of a home on Tulaney.
Right.
And it was during that time they entered. Three women were in the house alone with a one-year-old child.
Right.
They ran and barricaded themselves in a bathroom. The gunman kicked over the door of that bathroom, shot all of them in the bathtub, killing the baby.
Yes.
And the three women were hospitalized at Grady. I had an opportunity to go out and speak with them and promised them that we were going to bring justice to them and their family. But what was remarkably important during that time, and the point I'm trying to convey, it was myself along with clergy that you see in this room, myself and Bishop Carswell and others, you may remember Bishop, we went to the home that those women had to return to with a bathroom that was shot up and a back door that was kicked in. It was your clergy in your county of DeKalb working with their police department that brought to that family a back door being replaced and helping them to also be relocated and providing them with financial support because they were totally innocent victims. So in the short time that I have, I just wanted to mention that just to illustrate the importance of police community relations. We have had our challenges, but each challenge that we have had, we have been able to overcome. And we're going to continue to need your support, your help, and your collaboration with us. This is not new. I have been working with these men and women in this community and the clergy community for the last 4 years. And as we move forward, we hope to continue to embrace each other, strengthen that relationship. But even more importantly, we need all of you that are in this room. We have a great CEO that we've been waiting for. He's here. But more than anything else, you know and I know, is that he's going to need all of us to make this county great again. Thank you very much.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It is my pleasure to be here this morning to celebrate the inauguration of our new CEO. Always good to work with Michael Thurmond. We've worked with him for many, many years. Dr. Flippin, and to all of the brother, sister clergy. This year, Victory will celebrate our 30th church anniversary. We've been a part. We started in March of 1987. And this year will mark our 30th year, and we've been a part of this community, a part of this county, a part of working to build unity and coalition. That's been our overall theme for the morning, if you've been paying attention. Unity and coalition across religious lines, racial lines, gender lines, sexual orientation lines. And we're grateful to be a part of this collaboration. Coalition doesn't come by happenstance. You got to put some intentionality to it. And so I'm happy to be working with the CEO and all of my brothers and sisters to build that kind of collaboration. I think Andy Young has already set the tone for what we need to be about. I will just put a caveat on it by saying this. After church one Sunday, about five of my officers and I decided to go to Papa Do's for dinner. And we got down to Papa Do's. Three of us were there, and so we went up to the dias and we said, we'd like a table for five. And the young lady said to us, is your party present? And we said to her, three of us are here, two are on the way, but we want to go on ahead and sit down. She said, I'm very sorry, but I cannot seat you until your entire party is present. Mm. I was a little irritated at that. But I went on to the bar and ordered me a rum and coke. And while I was sitting at the bar, the Holy Ghost spoke to me. Because the Lord speaks to me in those places. And the Holy Ghost said to me, now here you are mad because you can't be seated.
All right.
But it's not Papa Do's fault. Because Papa Do's is ready to serve you. Papa Do's has all the food you need.
All right.
But you need to get your party together.
All right.
And then you can be seated.
All right. Come on now.
God says, I'm going to bless you.
All right.
I've got all of the help, support, encouragement, empowerment, unity, community building that you need. But if my people who are called by my name will come together, we'll look over racial lines, class lines, and understand that we have more in common than we could ever have apart because God hath made of one blood all nations to dwell upon the face of the earth. If we come together, if we can get our party together, God can bless us. God can seat us.
God can make a way for us. I'm glad to be in the party, and I'm glad we are coming together. It's a new day for DeKalb County.
That's not even fair. That's not even fair. I should have gone first and then Dr. Alexander and then let Dr. Samuels do the benediction, amen? I mean, boy, how can I come behind that except let the church say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
And amen. Amen.
So we're just gonna be about helping our new CEO, Mike Thurmond, his lovely wife, and all of us in DeKalb County. I bring you greetings from Rainbow Park Baptist Church and DeKalb Pastor Alliance. And we are also just coming together. Want every person here, you're a member of a church. Every pastor needs to be a part of the Alliance. Because the Alliance worked together with Dr. Selig and Zander. We worked together with other different organizations. And we just want to show our church, our congregations, that we can do as clergy what we tell them to do. Because too often we tell them to do things that we don't do. Amen? So every church is a part of DeKalb County. And it's not just South DeKalb, it's DeKalb County. Meaning all pastors, male, female, all clergy of this ecumenical breakfast to come together so that we can look at the county, help law enforcement, help the CEO, so we can be proactive. We're not going to be a reactive organization, but a proactive organization, so we can solve problems before the problem becomes a mammoth of a problem. Amen? Amen. Amen. And so that's what we're going to do. So CEO, you have our support. We're going to support you. And also, you know, you want us to hold you accountable.
Yes, sir.
Amen?
Yes, sir.
As well as with law enforcement. We're going to support them, and then we're going to hold them accountable. And we want you guys to hold us accountable. Amen?
Amen.
Even before the rum and coke.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, that's all I really want to say, because Dr. Samuel really just stole the show. When preaching up here, I thought we was talking, but he went ahead and preached. But no, we're good. All pastors want you to see me briefly at the end so that we can get your information, so that we can really be spiritually connected, so that we can really protect our CEO, because this is a spiritual war that we know we're in. Amen? And for the next 4 years, believe me, we're going to need to really be full armored up for whatever life brings our way. Amen?
Good morning. Good morning. Thank you all so much for having me here this morning. It's such a pleasure and a blessing to be a part of this celebration. I am so excited to get started in DeKalb County with Michael Thurmond. If y'all will bear with me for just a moment. I don't know about tomorrow, I just live from day to day. I don't borrow from its sunshine, for its clouds may turn to gray. So I don't worry about my future, for I know what Jesus said, and today he walks right beside me. For he knows what lies ahead. Many things about tomorrow I can't seem to understand.
Well, that just is not fair. I can't preach. I can't sing. This isn't fair. But I do have one thing to share from Hillel the Elder, who lived about 2,100 years ago, just before Jesus came on the scene. Hu Haya Omer, he used to say, Im ein anili mili. If I am not for myself, who will be for me? Uch she'ani le'atzmi ma'ani. But if I am only for myself, what am I? Ve'im lo achshav ematai. And if not now, when? I dare say that we have heard this morning about the imperative to work across apparent divides and real divides. I've heard this morning the call for solidarity and wisdom, of humility and compassion and solidarity. I hear that we need to be advocates for our own issues as well as standing along with our brothers and sisters whose interests and stakes are different from ours,
right,
lest we continue to divide this country as we have seen it in the last year or so. And that final question, if not now, then when? The urgency of now is ever more apparent.
It is.
We are not so rich as to afford the luxury of despondency. And I am so proud to have Mike at the helm, cheering us, leading us, goading us to do what we can to bring a brand new day to DeKalb County. I look forward to working with you.
Thank you so much. Let us all stand.
The central prayer in the Jewish tradition concludes with a prayer for peace, which says, Ose shalom b'mermav, hu ya'ase shalom, aleinu ve'akol Yisrael v'imru, amen. May the one who sends peace and brings peace and makes peace in all of the world do so in bringing peace to all of humankind. And may we all say, amen.
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 Thank you for coming today. Thank you so much. If you're not preaching tomorrow, come to the Grove.